On March 1, 1954, Lolita Lebron, Rafael Miranda, Irving Flores, and Andre Cordero stood in the visitors' gallery at the House of Representatives in Washington. They unfurled the Puerto Rican flag and shouted, "Puerto Rico is not free." Then, taking out handguns, they shot directly into the chamber below, wounding 5 congressmen. They were arrested immediately. Lolita Lebron has been in jail for 23 years. Conrad Lynn was her lawyer in Washington, and then later in New York, where she and many other nationalist leaders were tried for conspiracy.
My defense was basically that this was a dramatic act of protest, which was justified because of the illegality of the occupation of Puerto Rico by the United States. The nationalists believed that the United States was illegally in Puerto Rico, and they never recognized the sovereignty of the United States government. Therefore, a nationalist, such as Lolita Lebron, and specifically Lolita Lebron, even though she was suffering from lack of a job, and therefore she did not have an opportunity to have food for herself and her child that was with her in Brooklyn, she refused to accept relief. And therefore, life was very harsh for her.
Lolita was a follower of Don Pedro Albizu Campos.
Albizu Campos had said that in the Jones Act passed by Congress, 1917, we had the legal enslavement of the Puerto Rican people, the death of their dreams of independence. This was an act of the American Congress. It is true that the president signed the law, but it was the debate in the Congress that specifically had come to his attention, and it was at that time the last or one of the later expressions of the concept of manifest destiny, that the United States had been called by God from 1898 on to rule over these people who were the lesser breeds. And it recalled to mind Rudyard Kipling's poem, which had been first published in the United States, The White Man's Burden. And so this is what was in the mind of Albizu and in the mind of Lolita. There was an insult to the Puerto Rican people expressed, not simply political domination. It was the insult. The Puerto Rican people are an amalgam of peoples, Indian, blacks, and whites. And when we talk of when Kipling talked about lesser breeds without the law, he's talking about these so-called half-breeds, and it was an insult and impugning of their racial heritage that was instinct in what she was trying to avenge by that deed, not just the act to obtain Puerto Rican independence. It was a reply to a national humiliation.
I questioned Conrad about the emphasis that both Lolita and Albizu put on sacrifice. Was this a heritage from their Catholic backgrounds?
Yes, it's also related to the Inca fatalism, the fatalism of the Aztecs. Yes, well, you remember, these people are not just of European origin, they're also of Indian origin. And in Mexico and in Peru, you have great traces of the Aztec and the Inca influence. Now, when Albizu made his great speech at Fajardo in December 1949. That's when he made the greatest expression of what you were just talking about, this matter that you must be ready to sacrifice your lives. He made the whole assembly stand and take the oath that we will advance over the bones of Albizu if necessary in order to win our independence. In other words, they were all ready to make the sacrifice that Albizu would make, which would be his life. See, so therefore it is absolutely true that they believe in the necessity of valor and sacrifice. At the time of the uprising in 1950, five nationalists assaulted the governor's palace. He was surrounded by troops, a whole company of troops with machine guns, and five felt called upon to assault the governor's palace, just five men, and they were all riddled with bullets, of course, before they got to the steps of the governor's palace. But they were the nationalists. They felt they had to make that sacrifice. It was a symbolic attempt to end the rule of the representative of American imperialism. See, that was the way the nationalists looked at it. Now, of course, as the Puerto Ricans say now, and many Puerto Ricans I know, that man asked for too much. you can't have a race that consists only of heroes. You know, that's not possible.
So, but that certainly was something that Lolita.
Oh yes, yes. Oh, she represented that. She represented exactly that point of view. See. And that, of course, is her main danger to the American hegemony, because Lolita is such an inspiring figure that I can understand the government not being too anxious to let her out. Now, for example, when she went to the funeral of her older daughter, who died in an automobile accident, I believe it was. They let her go to attend the funeral in Puerto Rico. Now, they could have let her stay there. They could have let her stay there. But I suppose they had second thoughts and brought her back to the prison because she had received such a reception in Puerto Rico. There would be a complete renovation of the nationalist spirit if they had left Lolita there. She wouldn't have had to do much except be there.
Do you think she's changed at all since she's been in prison?
Oh, no. She has simply her conviction of the rightness of her cause has simply been deepened. That's all.
What about, you mentioned that you were talking about how Norman Thomas came to visit.
Yes.
Albizu and
right.
Tried to...
Yes, when Albizu was taken to Columbus Hospital with the TB attack. He was visited by Norman Thomas, Roger Baldwin, John Haynes Holmes, and that Holmes Smith, was it, Mother?
Yeah,
Holmes Smith.
And
J. Holmes Smith. J. Holmes Smith. And all the leading American liberals, and especially the pacifists, who were anxious to paint him as the Puerto Rican Gandhi, which is completely, you know, I mean, they ignored his background, which was a certain arrogance about that, you know. They wouldn't bother to find out what his real intellectual background was. They were going to remake it, you know, and he became the Puerto Rican Gandhi. Albizu at no time espoused the position of Gandhi. He was just the opposite of Gandhi. And yet that's what they tried to paint him as. And Roger Baldwin, even today, Roger Baldwin is about 94 years old. And I saw him... No, he didn't. I saw him last year. You know, when they had this demonstration for me, the ACLU, and I went to this party over here?
Oh, okay.
He came over and didn't talk to me. Yeah, Roger Baldwin's still living. Yeah, he's still living. And Roger Baldwin would still pretend that he understood Albizu and Albizu was his friend, where actually the nationalists considered that Roger Baldwin betrayed them, because Albizu was courteous to him as he was courteous to everybody. He was a man of exquisite courtesy. And in Puerto Rico, later, the knowledge that Roger Bowen had gained from Albizu was used to destroy the Nationalists, so that the Nationalists were very bitter about Roger Bowen. And Roger Bowen became the leader of the International League for the Rights of Man and all that. And only the Nationalists in Puerto Rico dispute his image.
And none of those liberals supported Lolita?
Oh, no, not one of them. The only, as I say, the only person that I know, American, of any prominence, who supported Lolita in any sense was Waldo Frank, who... Now, there was Scott Nearing also. He had an understanding position of what she did, too. Scott Nearing. And I think Scott Nearing is still living. He's still living. What's that wrong with your eyes, Mother?
It must be
the
cream on my face got
into
it.
Oh. Yes, yes. Yes. And there was some sympathetic press because there are Americans who are radicals. And even liberals. Now, for example, the Nation didn't say it was justified. They didn't justify it. They said it was understandable. An act of madness speaks truth. That's what Waldo Frank quoted in the Nation, said about the assault in 1954. In this time where the Americans themselves have a completely irrational policy towards these aspiring people for independence. Madness must speak truth. This was Waldo Frank. So we had some eloquent voices who understood the anarchist expression.
Of course, the climate at the time wasn't too healthy for dissent.
No, this was the latter stages of the McCarthy period and dominance of American life. And of course, the scope of this act was such that it even made the McCarthy repression fade into some insignificance for a while, because this was such a dramatic challenge to his whole process of suppressing dissent. Historically, anarchism comes out of dictatorship and their forms of dictatorship. For example, the Russian Narodniks many times use anarchistic methods because the Tsar had such a overwhelmingly strong dictatorship, so that an organized democratic opposition could not arise. And therefore, you don't crush the human spirit. It's impossible to crush the human spirit altogether, no matter how great the dictatorship. And so, therefore, the acts of protest, the acts to affect social change, take the form of assassinations, of acts of terror. And this is true of all countries and of all peoples. It's certainly true in the Mediterranean region, and it was and it's certainly true in Latin America, that the dreadful and tragic destruction in Argentina is an example of this. And remember, Che Guevara came from Argentina. I mean, this whole tradition of the anarchist spirit was embodied in Lolita and in Albizu Campos. That's why this Gabriela Mistral said, when she was granted the Nobel Prize for Literature, that this should be given to the greatest living Spanish American. That was Albizu Campos, the very symbol of that propaganda of the deed.
What was it that after it happened, they asked him about it?
Oh, yes. And now, of course, he had been released from prison in 1953, and he was living in Puerto Rico. And after the attack on Congress, he was questioned as to whether he had anything to do with it. course he had nothing to do with it, but they asked him would he repudiate what she had said. He said he never repudiates the noble act of a patriot. And so, of course, they assumed that he was, they then used that as an excuse for saying that he must have been behind it, and he was re-imprisoned without any trial and stayed in prison from 1954 until 1964 for 10 more years.
I was wondering, like, what her contacts with him were, and how that progressed.
She was particularly influenced by Albizu's great thesis, which he had been enunciating for many years, that the woman is the expression of the nation, that you find in the activity of women the highest expression of the race. And so, of course, this appeal to a person who came from a background in which women were distinctly subordinated at all times. This is the Spanish, and not only the Spanish, Latin American background. Women played a very subordinate role. And on the other hand, he felt that women were the portent of the future. And so that, of course, was inspiring to her because she was a poet. And it was a sort of a mystical linkage that she had with Albizu. She did not seek a close personal tie. Of course, she was in the United States. Albizu was in Puerto Rico in those years immediately preceding this. And so that she wasn't a person who constantly was at his side. That is not so. It was this great intellectual literary connection that they had, because Albizu was a poet.
And she was a poet too?
Well, she had been writing poetry in Puerto Rico.
Uh-huh.
And she just continued to write poetry, because remember, most of the time, or a great deal of the time, she was unemployed in New York. She was unemployed. Now, the Nationalists knew of her talent, and so that even though she had refused relief in New York, they found a way to sustain her in a minimum sense. See, she was well known among the Nationalists in New York and highly regarded because of her poetic gifts.
Did she make speeches?
She would talk at meetings, and she would read some of her poetry. But she was not a person who pushed herself to the fore. There were many more, what they would call more political people, both men and women, who were active in, like, in young people in the communist movement or in the Trotskyist movement or in the socialist movement, who would be active, and they were professional revolutionaries. She wasn't that type. She was much more reflective, and she was religious. She was much more religious. And she, the religious side of Albizu also appealed to her. See, she was a mystical Catholic.
Now, did she feel that there was some kind of divine calling for her to do this act? Is that?
Yes. Oh, yes. That's right. She felt that she was destined by God to make a sacrifice for the Puerto Rican people. Now, that was completely misunderstood by the press and by the American people generally, because they said, how can she be making a sacrifice when she's going down there shooting up these congressmen? But she thought she would be killed, because that had been the experience in Latin America. You know, if that had happened in any Latin American assembly, there's no question they would have been immediately slaughtered. But that was a misunderstanding of the North American ethos. And so they were not killed, they were captured.
So was that a surprise to her?
It was a surprise to her, and it was a surprise to the other three. Surprise to all of them that they survived. That was a surprise to them. They had not counted on that. They thought they were going to be killed. When she led the three men to Washington, she insisted on taking full responsibility. She could easily have adopted the suggestion of the police that she was the dupe of these male so-called terrorists, and that since she had not actually shot anyone, since her 45 revolver had recoiled when she tried to shoot it and the bullet had gone into the ceiling, she insisted that she was primarily responsible because she was the leader of the band. Now, this is what we know about her sense of honor and her integrity. When she was offered parole, because her sentence was the shortest of the sentences, she refused parole unless the three who she said she had gotten into this whole adventure, unless they were released, she would not accept release. That's why she has become such a symbol, because of this great sense of honor, this belief that she must sustain a certain level of values, even at the expense of her own suffering.
And she lost both of her children.
Yes, she lost the first, the boy, just before the trial in New York City. The priest, the day before she was to testify, a priest brought her the news in the prison that her little boy, who was 12, had drowned in Puerto Rico. And we didn't know that when we put her on the witness stand. And she began, when we asked her the preliminary questions about her pedigree, then that recalled to her the fate of her boy, and she began talking about this to the court. And the judge was astute enough to see that this was a major tragedy, and he would not let her be interrupted. And she just talked the entire day about this, what her life had been with her child, and the meaning of his loss. It had a devastating effect on the courtroom. And we were in tears, of course, and the jury was in tears. The judge was very badly affected by it. But he let her talk on, and I guess in a sense that was very wise on his part. I suppose this made the defense less political, because it took on a new dimension because of what had happened to her and the suffering that she had undergone in the United States, in Brooklyn, which came out in her testimony.
So she talked about how hard...
Yes. She was saying to them how one morning she was she didn't have anything to eat, and she put her son on her shoulder and went into the gutter of the street to see if she could find a dime so she could buy some milk for him. And she couldn't find the dime, and she began to cry. And the little boy said to her, "Don't cry, Mommy. Someday I'll turn myself into a bird, and I will tuck you under my wing, and we'll fly far, far away." And it was at that point that the judge realized that this was not any ordinary testimony, and he signaled to the United States attorney, whose name was Edward Lombard, to let her continue, and she did.
Was any of that mentioned in the press coverage, like the people that
It was not mentioned in the press coverage because, you see, that would have obtained some sympathy for her. And they were very anxious, especially in New York City, with the largest concentration of Puerto Ricans of probably any city in the world, including San Juan. It was most important not to make those people become too excited, you see. So the press kept that, they kept silent about it.
People have questioned your defense of this in terms of the nationalists, and that in a sense your politics isn't necessarily a nationalist politics, and how do you reconcile this within your own sense?
Yes, it is true that as a Marxist, I would not have the point of view of the anarchist on the way social change is progressively affected, but the nationalism of the nationalist appeals to me. In other words, I think of the black people in this country as a colonized minority, not just an oppressed minority, but a colony inside the United States. And I first came to believe in communism in 1928 because of my belief that it was for the freedom of all colonial peoples. And I felt that the black people in this country must win their freedom by ending their internal colonial status. So the nationalism of the nationalists appealed to me, that assertion of the right to independence. That, of course, was a theme that always had affected me long before I became a communist. That goes back to as a very small child. So that the theme of independence always has fascinated me from the first time I read the Declaration of Independence as a grammar school child. So that was that nationalism, the desire for independence, that appeal made the nationalists appeal to me. And it transcended my Marxism. My attachment to both Albizu and Lolita was deeper than my attachment to Marxism.